Thank you. Please join me for the unison call to worship. In the hustle and bustle of every Advent season, it is easy to get swept up with the business of preparing our homes for guests, visiting friends and families, and finding the perfect gift for our loved ones. Let us take a moment to slow down and remember what Advent is meant to be, a time of waiting for the coming of Christ.
Our opening prayer. Heavenly Father, you sent your messengers to tell of the birth of your Son, that people might believe in him. Open our ears to hear your call, to repent of our sins, and to seek our heavenly inheritance. May we profess Christ until we stand at your face, in the glory of your majesty. Grant this for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. I'm not going to let you back, have you?
Advent is the season when we prepare ourselves to receive God's gift of Jesus. It is a time of getting ready for the celebration of Christmas. The mood of Advent is that of longing, expectation, and waiting. Advent is a time when we yearn for Jesus to come back to completely remake all things as the returning King. The cry of Advent is of those who have experienced injustice in the world under the curse of sin, and yet who have hope of deliverance from the God who hears and is not silent. Advent is a time to repent, to believe, to turn away from the false hopes that define our lives and determine our drive so much that it twists us into people who use and oppress others. Advent is a time to find the reality of life with God, the freedom that sets us back on a path of goodness, joy, and love. This is the first Sunday in Advent. Today we light one purple candle. This is the candle of hope. Advent is a time of waiting and hoping. We wait for the day when we celebrate again the birth of Jesus. We hope that everyone will come to know God and to worship God. When we look at the first candle, we remember God's promise to send the Savior to the people. When we listen to our scripture reading, we hear what the prophet Isaiah wrote about God. God is the potter who molds us. We know that the gospel witness is one that helps us understand that God is loving and just. God brings peace. This gives us hope. We anticipate again the birth of the baby Jesus, remembering that Jesus helps us to know God's love for us. From Isaiah 64:8, why didn't But you are our Father, Lord. We are like clay, and you are like the potter. You created us. Think about a potter. A potter takes clay and forms it into a way that is pleasing. That is what God is able to do with each person. We are reminded that we are all the work of God's hands. Join me in prayer, please. Dear God, thank you for your Son, Jesus. Thank you for the words of the prophet Isaiah that remind us that you are the source of our hope. Help us to live each day, allowing you to form us in a way that brings about your kingdom here on earth. Amen.
Please rise for our first song in the 120, the Advent of our God.
Thank you. may the peace of Jesus Christ be with you. And also with you, let us share the peace of Christ with one another.
Peace be with you.
We have used the word Advent, like you add numbers, Advent. Advent is a special time in the life of each Christian boy and girl and man and woman. And the word Advent means to wait, waiting for something. Now, I don't know about you, but I'm not very good sometimes at waiting. I remember on Thanksgiving Day smelling the turkey and the potatoes and everything, the yams with the marshmallows on top, and I remember asking, is it time to eat yet? And my family said, no, you're going to have to wait a little bit longer, and then a few minutes later, is dinner ready yet? Sometimes when children go on trips, every parent and grandparent knows. But, and you keep on saying, right? Are we there yet? You know what? As we enter the season of Advent, which means the coming of something, we're going to be celebrating Christmas in a few weeks. But as children of God, we celebrate the birthday of Jesus. And I want you all to be here. The Sunday after Christmas. Christmas this year is what? On Saturday? And so the next day is Sunday. If you're all here, we're going to have a birthday party for Jesus. We're going to sing happy birthday to Jesus. So Advent means waiting. So I want you to see something that we have in the church to help us to wait. Look up here. This is called an Advent wreath. And these are called Advent candles. And every Sunday over the next few weeks, we are going to light a candle. So next week, that one will be lit. But next week, we do this one. And then this one. And then this one. And then we know we're really close to Christmas. And then on Christmas Eve, the night before we celebrate the birth of Jesus, we light this big white center candle, which reminds us that it's Jesus' birthday. So, as we think about Christmas, and as we think about waiting for Christmas, we also wait for Jesus' celebration of his first coming. Finally, before we pray, do you know that the Bible says that Jesus is going to come back? Jesus is going to come back, yes?
They had that big parade that Jesus was coming
Exactly, when Jesus went into Jerusalem, right, on Palm Sunday, they had a big parade with palms. Before you know it, we'll be doing Palm Sunday here. So we need to wait, and we need to be ready for when Jesus' birthday comes. And we get ready by hearing the good news, the stories about the shepherds, and the story about the wise men, and the story about Mary and Joseph. All of those wonderful stories we can hear in the weeks ahead. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for this time in which we look forward to the coming of your Son when you celebrate his birthday. Lord, help us, because waiting is sometimes very hard. And yet, Lord, you care for us and you love us. And so, Lord, help these children in the weeks ahead to wait upon you and to be excited about the celebration of your birthday. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
We have some papers for you to take. Children's Church, I'm going to give them to you today. Okay, so we dismiss our children, the children of the church. Let's bow together in prayer. Lord, we do have a hard time with waiting. Waiting to hear the report from doctor's visits. Sometimes waiting in traffic. Sometimes waiting for food and for meals. And yet, Lord, you have promised to be with us in our waiting. That there is expectation and excitement in the celebration of the birth of your Son, Jesus Christ, who changed life as we know it, who came that we might have life and have it to the full. And so we thank you, Lord, for calling us into your kingdom. You knew our names before we were even born, and as the psalmist says, you did knit us together in our mother's womb, and we are wonderfully and fearfully made. Lord, help us not to be distracted in the weeks ahead with activities and plans. Let us remember to remember the birth of Christ. And to prepare, as we read the stories of the wise men and the shepherds of Mary and Joseph. And so, Father, slow us down in these days that go by so quickly. Give us light and peace and strength and hope. As we listen to the news around us, in our communities and in our nation and around the world, May we not fret or fear, but may we place our faith in the one who holds all things together, Jesus Christ. Open your word to us today, that we may not only hear your word, but that we may obey. For we pray all these things in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, who taught us to pray together by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. It is hard to believe that Advent is here, and there are many wonderful stories, and today we begin our Christmas message concerning the birth of John the Baptist. John the Baptist and Jesus were related, probably cousins. And in our lesson today, we hear of the marvelous surprise that God had in store for Zechariah and his wife Elizabeth. Let us hear God's word. In the time of Herod, king of Judea, there was a priest named Zechariah who belonged to the priestly division of Abijah. His wife Elizabeth was also a descendant of Aaron. That's the priestly line, the line of Aaron. And both of them were righteous in the sight of God, observing all the Lord's commands and decrees blamelessly. But they were childless, because Elizabeth was not able to conceive. And they were both very old. Once, when Zechariah's division was on duty and he was serving as priest before God, he was chosen by lot, according to the custom of the priesthood, to go into the temple of the Lord and burn incense. And when the time for the burning of incense came, all the assembled worshipers were praying outside. Then an angel of the Lord appeared to him, standing at the right side of the altar of incense. And when Zechariah saw him, he was startled, and he was gripped with fear. But the angel said, "Do not be afraid, Zechariah. Your prayer has been heard. Your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you are to call him John. He will be a joy and delight to you, and many will rejoice of his birth. For he will be great in the sight of the Lord. He is never to take wine or other fermented drink. And he will be filled with the Holy Spirit even before he is born. He will bring back many of the people of Israel to their Lord, their God. And he will go on before the Lord in the spirit and the power of Elijah to turn the hearts of the parents to their children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the righteous, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord." Zechariah asked the angel, "How can I be sure of this? I'm an old man, and my wife is well along in years." The angel said to him, "I am Gabriel. I stand in the presence of God, and I have been sent to speak to you and to tell you this good news. And now you will be silent and not able to speak until the day this happens, because you did not believe my words, which will come true at their appointed time." And meanwhile, the people were waiting for Zechariah and wondering why he stayed so long in the temple. And when he came out, he could not speak to them. And they realized that he had seen a vision in the temple, for he kept making signs to them, but remained unable to speak. And when his time of service was completed, he returned home. After this, his wife, Elizabeth, became pregnant and for 5 months remained in seclusion. "The Lord has done this for me," she said. "In these days, he has shown his favor and taken away my disgrace among the people." May God, the Holy Spirit, who inspired these words, now apply them in our lives. Amen. Let's pray. Lord, I pray now that the words of my mouth and the meditations, the decisions of our hearts this moment would be acceptable in thy sight. For you, O Lord, are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Title of this morning's message, Speechless. There are occasions in life when we become speechless. Now, as your pastor, I can tell you, I don't know that I can ever remember a time when I was speechless. But many times people are speechless and they are filled with joy. I think of the videos, right, we see on television where our servicemen and women return and surprise their husbands or wives and their children. I'm sure for many of them, they're left speechless. Zechariah, the priest, became speechless. It is frustrating when you have good news to share and you cannot share it. I've told the story before that when my second grandchild, Ruby, was born, I was in Tampa Airport. I was getting ready to fly to a continuing education event, and we were on baby watch the night before. And so I'm in the terminal at Tampa Airport, similar to that picture there. And at 6:30, I get a text from Joni announcing the arrival of Ruby. And I look around the airport, and there's nobody around. There's nobody to tell the good news to. But it was interesting because on the flight, God happened to place me next to a woman who was pregnant. And so as I spoke to her about her upcoming delivery, and I couldn't wait to get my point in that I was a proud grandfather again for a second time. But there's some frustration in having great news and not being able to share it. Zechariah was speechless. Can you imagine being told after all these years and all the shame of being childless that you're going to have a child and not be able to say those words? That was part of the punishment of Zechariah for not believing what the angel had told him. I've shared the story at Easter time of a pastor who became very ill in his latter years of life. And every Easter, he would join with everyone else saying, "He is risen. He is risen indeed," right? You've got to keep that practice for next Easter. And as he became older, he became sick, and he actually lost the ability to speak. And he remembers the first Easter. How do we take things for granted, don't we? He remembers that first Easter when he was not able to proclaim, "He is risen indeed." And someone seeking to consult him said, "It must be very difficult not being able to say that." And he wrote these words, "It is truly a shame to not be able to say he is risen, to not have a voice to say he is risen. It is more terrible to have a voice and to not say it." Zechariah, so what are the applications of this passage in our lives? So the first thing I want to share with you today, a word to the elderly, which is just about all of us here today. God is not finished with you yet. I think of the story of Noah, who was well advanced in age. And I think these stories are in the scriptures to remind us of this application. He was very old when he started to build the ark. I think of Abraham in his old age and how God gave him the son Isaac when his wife Sarah was barren. And Abraham was the father of the nation of Israel. I think of Moses, about the time he was about 120, led the people out of Egypt. He spent the first 40 years of his life growing up in Egypt, having all the luxuries, and then you know the story. He was found after killing an Egyptian. He fled. And when he went out in the wilderness, and he, at the age of 80, God called him back. And Moses led the people out of Egypt. So, as we get older, right, there are certain things we can't do. For some of us, hearing becomes an issue. And there's a story told of a man who had hearing difficulty, and with the marvels of medicine and devices and so forth, The doctor looked in his ear and he said, I have the perfect solution for you. You're going to be able to hear just fine. And so he gave this man this ear implant in order to help him hear and said, I want you to come back in about a month. So he comes back in a month and the doctor said, how are you doing? He says, Doc, I can hear you so clearly. And the doctor said, well, you know, your family must be so excited that you can hear. He said, well, I haven't really told them, but I've changed my will 3 times. I think some people are guilty sometimes of selective hearing. So in the scriptures, in the story of Zechariah, there is no theology of retirement. That God takes great pleasure in using us in our age as we get older. He takes pleasure in using us in our infirmities and in our weaknesses and in our sickness. I've said before that any person who is young and healthy, when they do something great for the Lord, you know, you look at that and you say, oh, that's okay, that's good. But as we get older and we're not able to do what we used to do, God takes great pleasure. Hear this. God takes great pleasure and delight in using you. And you know one of the reasons why I think that happens? Because when we're young and we do things, you know, I often say sometimes I don't think God gave me a long enough arm to pat myself on the back. But when we're young, we can, you know, be kind of guilty of that. But as we get older and we see God working through us, we know that it comes from God. So you are never too old, and these kids that sit up here each week, you are never too young to be used by God in His kingdom. Second thing, as I read this passage that came across, God is full of surprises. It was a great surprise for Zechariah and Elizabeth to be told they were going to be parents. But you don't have to go very far in the scriptures, and as you know, all the Bible stories, that God constantly surprises people, right? I can think of a giant by the name of Goliath who was quite surprised one day when this shepherd boy went out to meet him. We know the surprise of Mary and Joseph when they were told that Jesus was going to be born. People were surprised when Jesus chose to eat at the home of taxpayers, of tax collectors, and sinners, and harlots. The people were surprised. People were surprised, like the woman caught in adultery, when Jesus said to her, your sins are forgiven. Jesus surprised his disciples on many occasions. And the greatest surprise of all is that God loves you. And God loves me. Despite our failings, despite our promises, to do better and to be better. I think as children, we know the wonder of being surprised. And as we get older, we kind of lose that part of life. It's around us, we just don't see it. God has a wonderful sense of humor, and God is surprising. It always surprises us. I want to share with you one of the most interesting passages in Scripture concerning answered prayer. It also is a surprise for the disciples. But in this story, you will see that the disciples of Jesus, who were trained by Jesus for 3 years, you're going to see their lack of faith as God performs a great surprise in their life. This is from the book of Acts, from the Message translation. Follow the story. So at that time, Peter was under heavy guard in the jailhouse. The church prayed for him most strenuously. And then the time came for Herod to bring him out for the kill. But that night, even though shackled to two soldiers, one on either side, Peter slept like a baby. And there were guards at the door keeping their eyes on the place. Herod was taking no chances. And suddenly there was an angel at his side and light flooding the room. And the angel shook Peter. He was sleeping so soundly that the angel had to shake him. He shook Peter and got up, "Hurry!" And the handcuffs fell off of his wrists. The angel said, "Get dressed, put on your shoes." Peter did. "Then grab your coat. Let's get out of here." Peter followed him, but didn't believe it was really an angel. He thought he was dreaming. Past the first guard and then the second, they came to the iron gate that led into the city. It swung open before them on its own. And they were out on the street, free as the breeze. At the first interaction, the angel left him, going his own way. That's when Peter realized it was no dream. "I can't believe this really happened. The Master sent his angel and rescued me from Herod's vicious little production and the spectacle the Jewish mob was looking forward to." Still shaking his head amazed, he went to Mary's house, the Mary who was John Mark's mother. Now the house was packed with praying friends. And when he knocked on the door to the courtyard, a young woman named Rhoda came to see who it was. Now, if you don't think God has a sense of humor, and it's not in the scriptures, just follow me here, okay? She came to see who it was, but when she recognized his voice, Peter's voice, she was so excited and eager to tell everyone Peter was there that she forgot to open the door. And she left him standing in the street. But they wouldn't believe her, dismissing her report. "You're crazy," they said. Now, keep in mind, they were praying, what? They were praying for Peter's release. She stuck by her story, insisting they still wouldn't believe her. "Well, it must be his angel." All this time, poor Peter was standing out in the street, knocking away. Finally, they opened the door, and they saw him, and he went wild. Peter put his hands up and calmed them down, and he described how the Master had gotten him out of jail and said, "Tell James and the brothers what happened." He left them and went off to another place. So God is a God of surprises. I remember years ago, before we moved to Florida, we were vacationing in Florida, and we were down there one year when there was a terrible hurricane on the East Coast, Cocoa Beach. And we were staying in Jen's mom's condo right on Cocoa Beach. And the hurricane came on the island. It took down electric poles. It shut everything down, caused a mess. We were about 20 miles away. And they said on the radio, nobody could get back into Cocoa Beach. And they set a date. And they said, after like 3 days, you can come back in. Well, there was a little bit of a problem because we were staying at my mother-in-law's place and they made it very clear on the radio, if you did not have identification to show that you lived there, they were not going to let you back on the island. And so I thought, oh my gosh, what are we going to do? Well, they were going to open up at 3 o'clock. We got in line with hundreds of other cars. And, I mean, we didn't have any identification, I mean, that we lived there. And so, we were just a couple of cars away. And I said, "Lord, I don't know what I'm going to say, what I'm going to do." So just at that time, remember I said, Colleen, it just so happens that these big rain clouds formed. Like within 5 or 10 minutes. One of those Florida storms. And it rained buckets. And it rained so hard that the policeman standing in the road said, "Enough of this. I'm getting in my car." Kind of reminds me of the angel thing, right? So we get past the first one. And we're about 3/4 of a mile away, right on the beach, and we come to a stoplight that was like not working still. And there was a second policeman in the road checking identification. And I thought, well, it had become sunny at that point, so the whole rain thing wasn't gonna work. So again, it just so happens, which is short, thank God, this is good. It just so happened that a television camera crew had pulled off to the side by the light. And what is it that police officers like to eat? Donuts? So the person gets out of the car just as we're approaching the intersection. The person gets out, walks over to the policeman, and hands him his donuts and his coffee. And we make our turn, and we're home free. God's full of surprises. And as we get older, let's remember that he does that. Here's a surprise that wasn't so good. There was a man one day who was homeless, didn't have a lot of money, looking for odd jobs and work to do. And so he knocked on the door of a very wealthy woman, and he said to her, "Do you have any jobs for me to do?" Well, she wanted to help him. And she had a porch that needed to be, Terry, take note, because this joke's particularly for you in your line of work. So she says, "You know, I have a porch, and it needs to be painted. I'm just getting ready to do that. There's some green paint out there. Why don't you go paint my porch green and come back, and I'll pay you?" So the man goes out. He's gone for about an hour or so. He comes back and he knocks on the door, and you know, he's got as much paint on him as he does on what he was painting. And so the woman paid him the money and thanked him very much. And the man said to her, "I have one issue, ma'am." She said, "What's that?" He said, "You asked me to paint the porch. I think you have a Mercedes."
Oh.
Get that back. You painted the Mercedes. Thirdly, finally, in this story of Zechariah, listen, God expects you to be a person of faith. However number of years old you are, God has prepared you to be strong in times like this and in the trials and circumstances that you face. God expects us as mature women and men to be people of faith. Barbara Walters, a number of years ago, interviewed Larry King. And she asked him some very direct and revealing questions. Two of the most telling responses came when she probed about fear and faith. And Barbara Walters asked Larry King, "So what is your greatest fear?" And he immediately replied, "Death." This interview occurred in 2005 when he was at the very top of his career. He had much to lose, but none of that mattered compared to his fear of death. But the second question she asked is even more telling. Her follow-up question was, "Do you believe in God?" He said, "I'm not sure. I'm agnostic." The truth is, regardless of our success, if we are uncertain about God, we will most assuredly be fearful of death. So the great Easter story. You cannot celebrate Easter without also celebrating Christmas without celebrating Easter. Reminds us that the fear of death is dissolved when we walk with the one who walked out of the tomb, Jesus Christ. Stories told of a little boy who would take train trips, and he was always very fearful. And one particular trip, he had to cross a body of water. And he could see the body of water, but he
but he didn't see the bridge. And he kind of held his breath, fearful. And then on the other side, there's a bridge. My friends, God has a bridge for you and for me. So that's a fact. It's not what the bridge is, it's who the bridge is. And that bridge is Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is our bridge. We are people of maturing faith. We are leaders. We are examples. However, as I close, we are also human, like two sides of a coin. I love the passage in the scriptures where a man said to Jesus very honestly, "Lord, I believe. Help my unbelief." We are still human. Adam and Abraham and Moses and David and Jonah and Zechariah should have known better. But lest we become too judgmental, we should know better as well. As God tests us, as God molds us, as Colleen said earlier about the potter and the clay, that God is in the process of preparing us to be more Christ-like. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for these words today. We thank you for the wonderful story of Zechariah and Elizabeth, how he was left speechless. But Lord, when his child was born, how I'm sure he talked and talked and talked. And so Lord, we thank you that no matter what our age, no matter what our condition, that it's not our ability that matters, but it is our availability to be used by you, to teach us, oh Lord, to continue to be used by you for your kingdom. Thank you for surprising us and for providing times of great joy and surprises in our lives. But Lord, may we be women and men of mature faith, that we may be able to show others what it means to be a Christian. And yet, Lord, help us, because we are human, and we make mistakes and we sin. Sometimes the same sin over and over. But you in your grace and in your mercy are always there to lift us up. In Jesus' name, amen. Let us now receive this morning's offerings and gifts. Thank you. Lord, you don't desire our gifts of gold and silver and money. You want our hearts. You want a contrite heart. And so, Lord, we pray that in our giving, whatever it may be, that we may be thankful, that we may be generous for your gifts. In Christ we pray. Amen. Let us conclude with our Christmas time affirmation. I believe that Christmas is more than a time for parties and ordinances. It is a time for remembering Christ and the incarnation of God's love in human flesh. I believe there are gifts more important than the ones under the Christmas tree. The things we teach our children, the way we share ourselves with friends, and the industry with which we set out to shape the new world in our time. I believe that the finest carols are often sung by the poorest voices, from the hearts made warm by the wonder of the season. I believe in the angel's message that we should not be afraid, that the child of Bethlehem is able to overcome all anxieties and insecurities. I believe in prayer and the quietness as a way of appropriating Christmas. That if I wait in silence, I will experience the presence of the one born in the manger. For he lives today as surely as he lived then. I believe in going away from Christmas as the wise men went, another way. I want to be different when these days are past, more centered, more thoughtful, more caring, and I believe God will help me.
Amen.
Let's just sing the first stanza, 123, first stanza only, O come, Emmanuel. Secondly, I want to call your attention to the Advent wreath. Ruth and Al Wilson purchased this larger size Advent wreath and the larger candles, and so we are very appreciative of that. Let's bow with this benediction. And now may the grace and the mercy and the peace that comes from God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. I thought of the final thing in my prayer. You know, that video, Angels from the Realms of Glory, one of the things I've noticed is that when you're alone in your office privately watching something, it's a lot different than when it's public. And so I would just encourage you, it's Angels, actually the title I have is incorrect, it's not Angels We Have Heard on High, it's Angels from the Realms of Glory. And if you type that in your YouTube search bar, Angels from the Realms of Glory, is that the right one? Gloria, Gloria, Angels from the Realms of Glory. It says next to it, the most beautiful Christmas carol ever heard. And so that's the one you want to look at. And I can tell you that when I watched that video privately in my office this week, I had tears in my eyes. Beautiful, beautiful. So I would encourage you to do that from week to week. Hope you all have a good week, and blessings to you all, and we will certainly keep you all posted concerning Jeremiah. Thank you. Let's do it.